Hello friends, today we are going to discuss about Preliminary Assessment under Juvenile Justice Act of 2015, amended in 2021. I am Dr. Suresh Badadmat, Professor of Psychiatry, working at NIMHANS, Bangalore. Before I start my presentation, I would like to place this disclaimer. This presentation is for academic and training purpose only, not for legal opinion. For legal opinion, please do contact an advocate. Conflict of interest? None. The objective of this video is to discuss about preliminary assessment. How to do this assessment? What is the legal framework? And what are the implications of the findings of the preliminary assessment? This video is targeted to psychiatrist, social worker, psychologist, mental health professionals, police, specifically for special juvenile police unit, counselors, advocates, JJ board members, CWC members, officers of observational home, probationary officers, judicial officers. Mahatma Gandhi has said this: if every saint has a past, then every criminal has a future. Here we are discussing about children, not to children in conflict with law. Children are the building blocks of our nation. How we are going to deal with the children plays a major role. Hence, there was a landmark legislation which was passed, which was titled as Juvenile Justice Care and Protection of Children Act of 2015, amended in 2021. This legislation discusses about two important population. One is children in need of care and protection and children in conflict with law. Let's discuss about both of them. Especially with regard to children in conflict with law, how the apprehension is done, detention, prosecution, penalty, imprisonment, rehabilitation, and social reintegration. These are discussed, and this is very specifically for children in conflict with law. However, it also talks about children in need of care and protection. Those are the children who are orphan, who are on the street, nobody is there to provide care for them, or children who are abandoned. So those children, what is the procedure and decisions, orders relating to rehabilitation, adoption, reintegration, and restoration of these children. So these important components have been discussed. Let's discuss when this preliminary assessment is done. It is done whenever there is a heinous crime is committed by the children. And Section 15 of the JJ Act clearly says that children in conflict with law under the Section 15 of Juvenile Justice Act is based upon the age, that is between 16 and 18, nature of the offence, that is heinous offence, and whether they had a capacity to commit crime. Both physical capacity and mental capacity has been discussed. But one need to keep in mind the children commit crime with issues related to the social background and under which circumstances they are coming from. And they are dependent upon multiple factors. So children in conflict with law should not be seen in a narrow line. It should be considered as a comprehensive assessment of the society, at the same time how the child is facing the environment. Hence, you need to understand the child comprehensively. Hence, you need to do the risk-taking behavior, impulsiveness, cognitive maturity, at the same time lack of foresight, peer pressure, influence of other adults, substance use, substance dependence, drug abuse basically, lack of supervision, broken families, socioeconomic factors, extreme poverty, child labor, child abuse, child trauma, exploitation, negative influences, and so forth play a major role in child committing a crime. You should not look through only a single lens telling that the child has committed a crime. You need to take the environment as a very important factor which determines the child to commit a crime. In this background, there was an amendment for JJ Act of 2015 that was basically for an important event which occurred. That was Nirbhaya rape case, which occurred on 16 December 2012. This was a gruesome rape and assault case. We can call it as a murder. The victim had to undergo 5 surgeries. Later, she died within 2 weeks. 6 accused gang raped her, and finally she was murdered. One of the accused was a juvenile. And this case was an important event which caused the amendment of JJ Act. Nirbhaya's struggle and death became a symbol of collective roar demanding justice, change in anti-rape law, and safety of the women across the country. This incident pierced the conscience of our society, and there was an unprecedented protest across the country with regard to safety of the woman. Although there were 5 adults and 1 juvenile, the lawmakers decided to amend both the laws, that is, rape law, that is Section 375 Indian Penal Code and also JJ Act of 2015. Both were amended. And this amendment under Section 15 JJ Act was clearly mentioned. In case of a heinous offence alleged to have committed by a child who has completed or as the age above the 16 years, the board shall conduct a preliminary assessment. So that was clearly mentioned. The JJ board, when it does the preliminary assessment, it will regard the considering the child's capacity, physical capacity, whether the child has capacity to commit such an offence, the ability to understand the consequences of the offence, and also the circumstances in which the alleged crime was committed. If the board finds the child needs to be tried as an adult, the board may transfer the trial of the case to the children's court. Now the question is, what is the heinous offence? The child has committed a crime, and the child is between 16 and 18 years. So what is heinous offence? Heinous offence has been defined in Section 2, Subsection 33 of the Act. The Act clearly says that the offence for which the minimum punishment under the Indian Penal Code or any other law for the time being in force, imprisonment of 7 years or more, will be considered as heinous offence. Now the question is, how long the preliminary assessment to be done and the report to be submitted? The preliminary assessment conducted in the case of heinous offence under the Section 15 shall be disposed by the board within a stipulated time period of 3 months from the date of first production of the child before the board. That means we have only 3 months. Within that, this preliminary assessment has to be completed. The question of what is the procedure for the assessment? The procedure for conducting the preliminary assessment is enumerated under Rule 10A, that is, the JJ Act as a rule, which was drafted and notified in 2016. The board shall in the first instance see if the child is above the age of 16 years, and then the preliminary assessment will be done. While making an assessment, the child shall be presumed as innocent. That is the rule of thumb. Now let's go into the deeper aspect of preliminary assessment. Under Section 15, the preliminary assessment plays very important 4 pillars. Whether the child had a mental capacity to commit a crime, physical capacity to commit a crime, whether the child is able to understand the consequences of the offence, whether the child is able to understand the circumstances of the alleged offence. So these are the important factors need to be considered, along with that, whether the child is between the age of 16 and 18. So these are the important components which needs to be considered when the preliminary assessment is done. What is the weightage of this assessment? The law is very clear. Preliminary assessment is not a trial, and therefore it is not detailed nor careful, or in-depth analysis is not done. It is a prima facie inquiry. Here the preliminary assessment will only dictate whether the child has the physical capacity and mental capacity to commit the crime, and what is the circumstances the child has committed the crime. And it will decide whether the child will be tried under the JJ board or in the court similar to adult. That is the only thing. It is not going to say whether the child has committed a crime. It is not a trial. The law is very clear about this. Now, what is the procedure? Here, the preliminary assessment, when it is referred to the expert, either it can be done inpatient or in the outpatient assessment. It is the discretion of the professional. Either they can do inpatient or outpatient. If the professional has time in outpatient, they can do the assessment in outpatient. However, considering we are discussing about a preliminary assessment, which is comprehensive, you need to do the family assessment. You need to know the circumstances in which the child has committed the crime. What was the offense? What was the child's mental thinking, mental capacity, physical capacity? Those need to be assessed. Not only that, you have to give recommendation how the child needs to be rehabilitated. As a professional, I would prefer to do inpatient assessment. However, there is no hard and fast rule here. It is left to the discretion of the individual professional. So, the assessment either can be done inpatient or outpatient. But however, who are the professionals who can do the assessment? Psychologists, psychosocial workers as mentioned in the legislation, or any other experts like child psychiatrist or any other psychiatrist. Let's be very clear. There are only few professionals across the country who are dealing with the children, especially children mental health, like child psychiatrist, child psychologist, or child psychiatric social workers are very few in number. We need to increase their number in our country. That means we have very few people to do the assessment. Now, when you do the assessment, you need to collect information from multiple sources, such as social investigation report, if you are able to get that well and good, social background report, whether the drug report, that is, substance abuse history of the child, physical capacity assessment, mental capacity assessment, detailed psychiatric evaluation. You can get information from the past psychiatric records, talking to the family members, talking to the child's friends, school, teachers, investigating officers, and any other person required, that is the professional discretion, will be exercised here. Collecting information from social investigation report. What is social investigation report? Social investigation report is been defined under section 2 and subsection 17. Social investigation report means the report of a child containing a detailed information pertaining to the circumstances of the child, the situation of the child on economic, social, psychosocial factors and other relevant factors and the recommendation thereon. This social investigation report will be asked both by the Juvenile Justice Board and Child Welfare Committee, because this assessment is done both in children who require care and protection and also child in conflict with law. These are mentioned in rule number 10, 11 and 64. That is social investigation report. This is a report which is prepared by probationary officer or the volunteer or an NGO along with the evidence produced by the parties. And form number 6 needs to be filled to consider that is a social investigation report. And that form number 6 is given in the rule of the JJ Act. This is how form number 6 looks, which has 4 pages. And now, moving further, there is one more report. You can collect information from social background report also. And it is given in the model rule 2016. What does it mean, social background report? This has been defined in section 2, subsection 16. Social background report means the report of a child in conflict with law containing the background of the child prepared by the child welfare police officer. And this is asked by JJ Board only under rule 8, subsection 1 and 5. The report is treated as an important document for the welfare of the child while deciding the case, because it has the background report and also the recommendation what to be done with the child. And this report will be considered either for the bail and also how the case will be dealt further. That means more than the preliminary assessment, social background report has a major weight on that. This is how form number 1 of social background report looks like. Moving further, another important report and information you need to collect, that is substance use report or drug abuse report. Here, you will be asking about the history of drug use, substance use, age at onset of drug abuse, family history of substance use, whether the child was under the influence of the substances during the commission of the crime. If required, urine examination of the child for drugs needs to be done. Next, moving to the important component, mental capacity of the child to commit the crime. Here, whether the child is able to understand the consequences of the offence and also the circumstances in which the alleged committed the offence. That is, you need to know both. That is, the mental capacity to understand the consequences of the offence and the circumstances in which the offence was committed. For this, you need to know the education of the child, intelligence, whether the child has mental disability, whether the child did preparation or planning for the crime, number of people involved in the crime, peer pressure, whether they were adults, pressure or influencing the child's behavior, motivation for the crime, nature of the crime, whether the destruction of the evidence was there, and threatening the witnesses who are there around, escaping, absconding from the place, or surrendering to the police. All these important factors need to be considered when you are doing mental capacity to commit a crime. Going further, physical capacity to commit a crime. Presence of any physical disability, whether there is any physical illness which restricts the child capacity to commit a crime, amount of force required to commit the crime, number of people involved in committing the crime, whether they were accomplice, whether they are adult, how much the adult played a responsibility in committing the crime, how much they influenced the child, height and weight of the child, general physical examination of the child. So these are the important component. Along with this, you need to do detailed psychiatric examination. That is required to do recommendation to the JJ board how the child needs rehabilitation. In this regard, you will take the demographic detail, reason for referral, accompanying documents, details of the charges framed against the child, history of presenting illness, past history, whether the child has committed crime in the past, family history, whether there is a broken family, whether the child is on street, personal history, whether the child was abused, sexual abuse, trauma to the child, temperamental history, mental status examination, and cognitive functions. I have done a detailed video regarding assessment of child that is available in my channel. Please go through that. Further, you need to do environmental assessment. Here, whether the child had any antisocial behavior, antisocial cognition, apathy, attitudes, belief, values, whether the child in the past had truancy, stealing, lying, any crime. Further, antisocial friends, associates, school, the role of work, if the child is working, child labor, family history, and poverty. Those are the things which you need to do the assessment. Now let's move into the format of preliminary assessment. To evaluate the role of the child in the alleged offense as well as his mental condition and background is the objective for the assessment. This report provides information on the child's mental condition and background. The background means developmental level of the child, family history, relationship, school and education, involvement in child labor, peer relationships, and experiences of trauma and abuse. That means you are going to do a comprehensive assessment. It also provides information on the mental health disorders, developmental disabilities of the child. Finally, the report should contain recommendation for treatment and rehabilitation intervention for the child. This is how the format of preliminary assessment is recommended. That is, name of the child, date when it was done, how much time it has been taken, age, hospital number, gender, place of origin, if there is any referral letter. If you have done the admission, you can mention the date of admission and date of discharge, or else you can mention the date of assessment started and the date of assessment was completed. That can be mentioned here. Further, moving to the first component, mental and physical capacity to commit the crime. Here, you'll be first discussing about the life skills, deficits, neglect, or poor supervision from the family, or poor family role model, experiences of abuse and trauma, substance abuse problem, intellectual disability, mental health disorder or developmental disorder, or any treatment given will be discussed in this mental and physical capacity to commit alleged crime. Further, circumstances of alleged offense, that is, family history will be taking in detail, school history, child labor, peer relationships, abuse and trauma, mental health disorder, and developmental disability will be discussed here. Further, the third component, child's knowledge of consequences and of the committing the alleged offense. That is, you will be discussing about the child's understanding of the social, interpersonal, and legal consequences of committing the offenses. Coming to the D, other observations, which is very important and that need to be mentioned. And finally, recommendation which you are going to give to the JJ board, how the child needs to be dealt with regard to the treatment, with regard to rehabilitation, counseling, or any other reformative measures to be taken. Now moving to the, once you are done, what to the challenges and opportunities for preliminary assessment under JJ Act. As you know, as soon as the Nirbhaya rape case occurred and the victim died, there was a committee was formed, that is Justice J.S. Verma Committee. It categorically rejected the demand for lowering the age of juveniles to 16. But unfortunately, the law was amended in the parliament. Now the question is, are we violating the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child 1990? At the same time, we have our own legislation, that is Commission for Protection of the Children's Rights Act of 2005. Are we violating that? Because children are defined as below the age of 18 years. We are going to treat a child between 16 and 18 as an adult. That means we need to question ourselves whether we are doing a right thing by asking for a preliminary assessment. And if you think that the child's mental capacity, physical capacity is there, that means we are going to try it as an adult. Is it right? That question needs to be answered. Now, the next important question is, can we assess the mental capacity accurately? That's a big question. And once it is assessed, can it be repeated again? That is the next question to be asked. Because mental capacity is dynamic in nature. At the same time, it is also specific. And it is evolving. Once the child is in the net of judicial process, he will learn by being a passive participant or observer. Imagine the child did not understand about the consequences of the crime or the offense. And once the child is arrested or taken to the police station, family members will threaten the child. People will start doing counseling. And child will be worried, what is happening with me? And finally, the child will understand, yes, if I do this, the police will arrest me. That means, before the preliminary assessment, the child has learned a lot of things. And when you do the assessment, you will get a false positive report. That means, are we doing justice? Now, at the same time, child is sent for examination after three months, in some cases after 3 years. That means, delay in the assessment has also been occurring. Because of various reasons, it may be COVID reasons, or else the child psychiatrist is not there, or child psychologist is not there, or assessment is delayed. In certain centers, the assessment takes a lot of time because there is a huge crowd waiting in outpatient department. Sometimes JJ board refuses to give social investigation report or even social background report. This is unfortunate because we will be doing the same social background report assessment once again to know the social situation of the child, how it entered into the crime. Further, looking at the counselors, untrained counselors who do not know how to deal with the children. In some instances, JJ board members do not know the biology of the child's brain development. And many a time, even the presiding officer doesn't know how to deal with the children. This is an unfortunate, and slowly we are training many of these judicial officers. Now, because of the lack of human resources and also pressure to assess in a time-limited manner, within 3 months you have to do the assessment. Many a time the child is produced on the day when the report has to be submitted. Imagine, by looking at the child's face, you are issuing a report. Now that means assessment is done in one sitting with intention to finish the procedure or to fulfill the deadline and in a mechanical fashion, rather than attempting to mainstream and rehabilitate, the child is not there. It is just a procedural aspect as it has become. Here, the spirit of the JJ Act is not taken into consideration. The only thing is, let's finish the procedure. Let's produce the child to the JJ board. Let's complete the procedure. That is what is happening. Here, nobody is bothered about the child's rehabilitation and reformation. And why the child entered into the crime, nobody is bothered about it. Further, if the child requires family intervention, de-addiction clinic, child clinic facilities, they are lacking in our country. Many districts do not have it. Only few metropolitan cities have this. Further, follow-up of these children in conflict law is very poor. I'm not talking about follow-up by the SGPU, that is police. I'm talking about the follow-up, rehabilitation, counseling, treatment by mental health professionals. That is lacking. To conclude, my dear friends, every child in conflict with law is a child in difficult circumstances who has fallen out of the protective net at some point and has been robbed of an opportunity of a safe and secure childhood. That means it is a collective responsibility of the society that child has entered into a crime. Because of the socioeconomic reason, because of the poverty, because we are not provided education to every child and equal opportunity is not there. And because of the poverty, the child is entering into child labor and the child is moving out of the school and many adults are abusing the children. And finally, the child has committed a crime. That means it is a collective responsibility of the society. It's not just the responsibility of the child who has committed a crime. Further, JJ Act of 2015 is becoming more of procedural. That is, trying the child for the crime. And the spirit of JJ Act is rehabilitation and reformation of the child. Unfortunately, it has been a million miles away. That is the saddest part of the whole JJ Act. Although we are unable to implement the act, rehabilitation and reformation is a dream. And it is a distant dream if you ask me. JJ Act Section 15 needs to be relooked and if required to be amended again, because preliminary assessment itself is becoming a procedural entrance rather than helping the child in conflict with law for rehabilitation and reformation. It is becoming a block rather than helping the child. This needs to be considered. This is my personal opinion. Thank you very much for giving your valuable time. Stay safe.